السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. All thanks and praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may His peace and blessings be upon His last and final messenger, His family, His companions, and those who follow them until the end of times. Ramadan Mubarak, Ramadan Kareem. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of our prayers, fasting, charity, supplications, recitation of the Quran, and all other good deeds that we will do throughout this very beautiful and blessed month. There is a very unique and strong connection between the month of Ramadan and the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Baqarah, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was revealed as a guide for humanity, with clear proofs of guidance and the standard to distinguish between right and wrong. One of the reasons why this month is so special, one of the main reasons why this month is full of all of these amazing blessings and opportunities, is because this is the month that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for the revelation of the Qur'an. And the Qur'an is simply amazing. Words can't truly capture the magnificence, eloquence, beauty, power, influence, and amazing nature of the Qur'an. The Qur'an is the divine, eternal, uncreated speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord, the creator of the heavens and the earth and everything they contain, the sustainer, the nourisher, the one who gives life, and the one who gives death. It is the last and final revelation sent for the guidance of humanity until the end of times. And the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the words of our Lord and creator, are extremely, extremely powerful. They are extremely profound. They are deep, they are heavy. They are beautiful, eloquent, and awe-inspiring. The Qur'an is the greatest miracle given to the Prophet ﷺ. It's a living miracle, something that we can experience today. And part of its miraculous nature is to have a profound effect upon our hearts and minds. The Qur'an is the absolutely most important book in our lives. And that's because the Qur'an is not simply a book. It's not like any other book. It's not a novel. It's not a magazine. It's not a textbook. It is the divine speech of Allah. His words revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is a very, very deep concept to reflect upon. That these words that we're reciting, these words that we're listening to, these are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these words are our primary source of beliefs, rituals, ethics, morals, principles, laws, and guidance. Our entire lives as Muslims is supposed to revolve around the teachings of the Qur'an. The Qur'an is our source of guidance. We use it to navigate through the world and live a life that is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is literally our manual for life that we use to build a path towards the divine. The Qur'an is our source of inspiration, our encouragement. It's the tool that we use to deal with the different challenges of life. And it contains guidance for every single thing that we do as human beings. But the only way for the Qur'an to serve this role in our lives is if we have a real connection and relationship with it. Our relationship with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be superficial. And that is because the primary objective, the primary goal of the Qur'an is for us to think, ponder, and reflect upon its meanings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's addressing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is a blessed book that we have revealed to you, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِ So that people can think, ponder, and reflect upon its verses. وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ And so that the people of understanding can be reminded. Alhamdulillah, during the month of Ramadan, all of us are trying to do something to strengthen our relationship with the Book of Allah. And every year here at IOK, we try to provide a short series with the intention of strengthening our relationship with the Quran and with the intention of increasing our understanding of His divine words. So this Ramadan, we are going to take a nightly journey through Suratul Mulk, 30 verses in 30 nights. And the goal behind this series is for us to, number one, learn how to recite the surah properly. Number two, memorize it, if possible. That by the end of this month, all of us will have Suratul Mulk committed to memory. Number three, understand it. And number four, implement its message into our daily lives. Now, Suratul Mulk is translated as the dominion or the sovereignty. It is the 67th chapter, the 67th surah of the Quran. It is the first surah of the 29th juz. It is the first surah of the 29th part of the Quran. And it's been called Suratul Mulk because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts the surah by praising Himself, by praising Allah, in whose hand alone is the sovereignty of the heavens and the earth. تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ وَهُوَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ Blessed is He, in whose hand is the dominion, and He is able to do all things. It is also known as الْوَاقِيَة, the protector. It's also known as الْمُنْجِيَة, the Savior, because it protects and saves one who recites it from the punishment of the grave. And the punishment of the grave is real. The Prophet ﷺ himself would seek refuge from the punishment of the grave. Right. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma used to call it al-mujadila, because it argues on behalf of the one who recites it when they're being questioned in the grave. It is a Meccan surah, meaning it was revealed before the migration of the Prophet ﷺ from Mecca to Medina, and it was most likely revealed during the earlier stages of prophethood. Some of the tafasir mention that it was the 76th surah to be revealed after Suratul Mu'minun and before Suratul Haqa. And just like all other Meccan revelation, Suratul Mulk deals primarily with the fundamental aspects of our belief. It speaks about the existence, the oneness, the might, the power, the glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It speaks about the concept of life after death, reward and punishment, paradise and hell. It deals with the formation and structuring of sound belief. That if we read this surah and we understand its message, it's going to help us construct sound and correct belief. It emphasizes the ultimate and complete power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Suratul Mulk speaks about Allah, the Creator, in such a way that makes our hearts feel His presence. And one of the reasons why I chose to cover this surah specifically is because it's one of the surah, it's one of the chapters that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encourages us to recite and memorize. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a surah of the Quran containing 30 verses will intercede for its reader till he will be forgiven. And that surah is تبارك الذي بيده الملك. Anas radiallahu anhu narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there's a surah in the Quran that will argue on behalf of its companion until it enters him into paradise. And that is تبارك الذي بيده الملك. In another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's the preventer, it's the savior, saving from punishment of the grave. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma narrated that one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put up a tent upon a grave without knowing that it was a grave. And in the night, during the night, there was a person reciting Surah Al-Mulk until they completed it. This person then went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, I put up my tent without realizing that it was on a grave. There was a person inside reciting Surah Al-Mulk until completing it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it is a prevention. It is a salvation, delivering from the punishment of the grave. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would not sleep until he recited Alif Lam Mim Tanzil and Tabarak Alladhi Biyadihi Al-Mulk. Imam Al-Qurtubi rahimahullah, the famous Mufassir, he mentions another narration from Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I wish that Tabarak Alladhi Biyadihi Al-Mulk be in the heart of every believer. So from all of these narrations, we can see that this is a very virtuous surah. Although some of these narrations may be weak, but because they're speaking about fada'in, because they're speaking about virtues, scholars have allowed us to act upon them in hopes of attaining that virtue and receiving that reward. So this is a surah that we should learn. This is a surah that we should memorize, and we should try to recite on a nightly basis. However, we should keep in mind that we're not reciting it simply for the blessings or the barakah. Rather, we're reciting the surah to reflect and ponder over its meanings. So I invite all of you to join me nightly this Ramadan, along with two of my beloved students, Sheikh Mudathir and Sheikh Aisha, to journey through Surah Al-Mulk, 30 verses and 30 nights. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this effort of ours. May He place it on our scale of good deeds on the Day of Judgment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this a means of strengthening our connection to the Qur'an. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it a means of increasing our love for the Qur'an. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give all of us the ability to not only recite the Qur'an and memorize it, but most importantly, implement its guidance and teachings into our daily lives. وَصَلِّ اللَّهُمَّ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا وَمَوْلَانَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلِّمْ جَزَاكُمُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ